Hi everyone, it's Katie, and today I have a bit of a fun video for you, which is a comparison between the Victorian Flower Oracle by Bubba Studios and the Floret Oracle. Now, the Victorian Flower Oracle by Bubba Studios is very much out of print, quite expensive and hard to come by, and it has been on my wish list for quite a long time because, as you may know, one of my all-time favourite tarot decks is the Fantastic Menagerie. And this is also by Bubba Studios and is based on the artwork of J.J. Granville. And what these two decks share in common is that they are based on J.J. Granville's art as well. And so, of course, I just thought that the Victorian Flower Oracle would make an absolutely incredible companion, but it wasn't easy to get my hands on. And then someone recommended the Floret Oracle to me, which is made by somebody else, but is essentially in many ways very similar. And it was like $25. So quite a while ago, over a year ago, I think I bought the Floret Oracle and I did a full flip through on my channel, which I'll leave a link to in the cards and in the description if you're interested. And this little deck has served me very well for quite a while and I do love it. But recently I made a video for 31 Days of Tarot, which was the deck on my wish list. And I had a couple of people contact me and offered to kind of fulfill parts of my wish list. One was Jacqueline. And another was Veronica Jude, who I'm kind of still overwhelmed by your generosity, my dear, because she bought and then sent me a copy of the Victorian Flower Oracle. So thank you to those people. Your generosity has been incredible and I do really appreciate it. And I thought this would be a fun little video for those of you, and I know there are plenty of us who wanted the Victorian Flower. I just wanted to do this comparison to kind of give you an idea of whether it is worth investing for you or whether you'd be happy with the Floret, because the Floret is a beautiful little oracle deck and there are a lot of similarities. So I will start by having a little bit of a talk about the Victorian Flower Oracle, which as I said is by Bubba Studios, although at the time of this publication they were known as Magic Realist Press, I believe. It does just come in this little tuck box. I know you can get the larger guidebook with this deck, but I mean obviously that makes it a lot more expensive these days. But in this tuck box, you do get a pretty substantial little white book, actually. It's similar to the Fantastic Menagerie little white book in, you know, that really kind of relatively thin, nice, glossy sort of paper. Not super glossy, but just very smooth. It's really lovely. And you actually get quite a decent amount of information. It's 32 pages. And this is the sort of information you get for each card. So not a huge amount, but I do think, you know, for a little flower oracle deck, you get quite a bit. And it talks a little bit about using the cards and how to read them. And it also talks a little bit about, you know, where this imagery and the inspiration for these cards come from, which is a certain set of work by J.J. Granville, which I think was also his most popular, successful work. So that's the little white book. Now we have 40 cards in the Victorian Flower Oracle, and this is the backing, which has this kind of really subtle gold. Like, it's not full on foil, it's just kind of like this. I don't know, it's really quite pretty. It's very cool. And we have Magic Realist Press written here and then the Victorian Flower Oracle at the top. So that's very, very cool. And the cardstock is pretty much like my Fantastic Menagerie, as you might expect. They were both published around the same time. It is quite thin. Indeed, you know, it's fairly thin. And it's not completely matte, but it's not at all glossy. It just has this really lovely sheen to it. And when I say they're thin, they are thin, which makes them very easy to riffle shuffle, but they feel quite dense at the same time. I don't know if that makes any sense. Like, they don't feel like paper. There's something really quite nice about this cardstock that I really enjoy. They're very thin and bendy, but they don't feel fragile or like you could easily tear them. I'm not sure if that makes sense. And obviously we have the name of the flower or the name of the card, along with kind of like a keyword. Some have a little bit more than one keyword, but it's not much at all. It's just, you know, this small little part down here. And we do have kind of this like pretty delicate little very, very soft yellow border. But as you can see, they're very, very beautiful. As for the Floret Oracle, we get 44 cards along with these extra two cards, which is just like the title card, I suppose, and this little cute note. So there are 44 flowered cards, and this is what they look like. They have this kind of pretty little border here, the name of the artwork or the flower, and then we have three keywords down the bottom. These are quite a bit smaller, the card size, and like quite a bit smaller. These are pretty much a traditional tarot size, whereas these are more, I don't know, they're just a lot smaller. I don't know technically what size they are. And the cardstock is quite different. They're a little bit thicker. They're quite a bit thicker. But they're still, you know, relatively bendy. And they kind of have that slightly more, like, it's not plasticky glossy, but they're like quite a bit more shiny than the Victorian flowers. But I do actually quite like this cardstock. It reminds me of like the Mesquite Tarot and my Elements of Recovery, like that sort of quality cardstock, which I actually quite enjoy. There is no guidebook with this deck. I don't even think I got a box with it. This was pretty much, you know, as is was how I received this deck. But as I said, it was about 22 or 23 Australian dollars from memory. So it's a bit of a bargain. Now what I've done is divided each deck into three different piles. The first, which is the one that I'm going to show you first and is the largest, is where basically the cards overlap in terms of the imagery. So these cards that I'm about to show you, which is the majority of both decks, is where, you know, the cards, the pictures are the same. They will each have slightly different meanings and keywords. But you know, the images here come from the same artwork. Now obviously with these two cards you can see quite clearly that the aesthetic is a little bit different. In the Victorian flowers, which is this larger one on the right hand side, the colors are a little bit more saturated and I guess a little bit more warm as well, whereas on the Floret Oracle they're a lot softer, more pale, a little bit more delicate, I suppose you might say. This feels like there's more of an outline or something to the artwork, and there's more of a contrast between light and shadow. Now, so let's go through, and I'm just going to kind of flip through and show you where these decks overlap. So of course we have Cactus as our first one. Here the keywords for the Floret Oracle are loneliness, isolation and challenges, whereas the title here in the Victorian flowers is a prickly situation. Now if we have a look in the white little white book, which I won't do for all of the cards, but for this one with the cactus, the keywords are an irritation, something that makes you feel uncomfortable or cross, an unapproachable person or situation, or a challenge that needs to be handled with care. So, I mean, you definitely see the similarities between these two cards and their meanings, although they are slightly different. Now we have the Cornflower and Poppy. And again, these are quite different in many ways. This is creativity, skills, and talent, whereas this one is an admirer. So this is cute. I feel like this feels a little bit more cartomancy predictive in many ways, whereas the Floret is more traditionally what we see in a lot of modern oracle decks. Now we'll have a quick look at this one again, just to give you an idea. So here we have a gallant suitor, a fan, someone who believes in you, a paramour, a patron or supporter, an admirable action or recognition of your talents. So we do see, you know, the talents and skills coming up here. There's just more of an emphasis on somebody else coming up in your life as like a supporter or an admirer, whereas we don't really see that in this one. This one is more centered on you, on your creativity, on your skills, on your talents, whereas this one is more centered on somebody else recognizing those things in you. Our next card is the Dahlia, and we have choices in the Victorian flowers, whereas it is grace, beauty, and luxury in the Floret. And we can see here that even the colors are changed in the Victorian flowers. Now, I'm not familiar with J.J. Granville's original artwork, but as you can see there's actually quite a bit of a difference in terms of how these different pictures are colored in. Quite clearly the two obvious examples are this large flower at the top. This one's blue, this one's quite a rich reddy pink, and this flower on the front is red and yellow in this card. This one's also a lot more cropped, as you can see. You know, this one is kind of like the whole image, whereas this one we kind of have a bit cut off here. Of course these are all small things that I'm noticing, but this is a comparison video, so I'm going to be pointing out those things that are different. Now we have the daisy, and this one is innocence, purity, and beginnings, while the Victorian flowers is family matters. And of course, you can see the overlap there where, you know, innocence, purity, new beginnings might be associated specifically with children, as we see these kind of smaller people, what I'm assuming to be children in the image, whereas this is kind of more broad and family matters. But that very much could be that more, you know, children, childbearing, child raising. Our next one is the flower market, and in the Victorian flowers we have a competition, and in the floret it's business, career, and trade. So again, similar if we break them down to the core, but still different in terms of their approach and what they're specifically referring to. And I think this is a pretty clear example of where this imagery is a lot softer, you know, whereas, you know, just on this sign, we can see quite clearly that there is quite strong writing. This is kind of not blurred, but it's softer. It's not as sharp, but that also means that it, in many ways it's much prettier, more delicate, rather than maybe a little bit more striking. And again, we see slightly different colours used in some of the flowers here. Next up, we have forget-me-not. We have a farewell in the Victorian flowers, and letting go memories, a farewell in the floret. So quite similar between these two. Now we have grapevine, expansion, growth, development, and intoxication in the Victorian flowers. So these are very different. And in the little white book we have down here, the keywords for grapevine in the Victorian flowers is losing your head, intoxicating events, celebrating, ecstasy, feeling high, letting your hair down, being indulgent to yourself, enjoying good times, a little of what you fancy does you good. So these are very, very different cards. Now we have hawthorn, we have balance, necessity, acceptance, and a necessary evil. So the meanings are quite similar with these two, although this one is kind of sharper and more to the point, whereas this is kind of a little bit more affirmative in terms of, you know, there is a necessity involved, but what you need to do is acceptance or balance or whatever it may be, whereas this is more just pointing to the issue. So our next card is hemlock, and here we have suspicion, toxic betrayal, or treachery and deception. So these are quite similar. And again, we can see how the Victorian flowers is quite a bit more cropped compared to the floret. Next we have honeysuckle. And these are kind of similar, but a little bit different. In the floret, it's sweet love, playful tenderness. And in the Victorian flowers, we have simply games. So we still get that playfulness, games, but it's just got a little bit more of a softer approach, I suppose, in the floret oracle. Next up we have jasmine, and in the floret we have family, bonding, home, and in the Victorian flowers it's compassion. So again, I mean, there's certainly similarities, like, you know, you usually associate family and bonding with some sort of compassion or something close to that emotion, whether it's love, connection, it's just done in a slightly different way. Our next card is lilac, and we have message, romance, affection, or quite simply a message. So again, quite similar, just a little bit more direct of a message in the Victorian flowers. Now for lily, we have commitment, union, partnership, and pure motives. So this is interesting in the sense that, you know, we would hope for pure motives in a commitment, a union, or a partnership, but that's not explicitly specified in the flowers, the floret oracle, apologies. Whereas with the Victorian flowers, you know, it's not specifically referring to a commitment or a union, but it's talking about the motives behind, whether it be an action or a union or a partnership. Although we might assume that it's some kind of union or partnership, given her dress looks quite a bit like a wedding dress. Also, you'll notice another difference here is like this little beetle, a cockroach or whatever it is, looks much more cockroachy in the Victorian flowers as opposed to the floret. It's got a bit of a more colourful beetle look. And indeed, this whole image is a lot darker with this kind of really black background. It looks a bit more ominous, despite pure motives being the title. Next we have marshmallow, and here we have healing, sickness and recovery, and sickness and health. So quite similar for these two. So here we have mimosa. We have sensitivity, prophecy, awareness, and in the Victorian flowers, it's just simply sensitivity. So we still have the sensitivity, although it's expanded upon a little bit more here. I guess there's kind of two types of sensitivity, you know, sensitivity in terms of just, you know, being sensitive to other people's emotions, being sensitive in terms of, you know, your emotional connection to other people. Whereas this one seems to be more explicitly focusing on, you know, sensitivity in terms of energy, being an empath or a psychic in some way. Whereas this one could kind of go either way a little bit more. Now we have narcissists, and these are quite similar. We have narcissism, vanity, arrogance, and vanity. Now we have nasturtium. We have sadness, grief, stillness, and sad memories. So they're quite similar in many ways. Now we have opium poppy, illusions, imaginations, unclear, dreams and illusions. So similar in so many ways again. Now we have orange blossom or orange flower. So, I mean, they're the same image, almost exactly the same title. I assumed these to be the same card in many ways. And on the Floret Oracle, it's good fortune, fertility, self-love. Whereas in the Victorian flowers, it's memories. So these really are quite different. And even in the little white book of the Victorian flowers, there's no indication of, you know, these sorts of meanings coming up. It is much more memories and things like that. So very different interpretations of those cards. Now we have pansy. In the floret, it's wishes, dreams, contemplation. And in the Victorian flowers, it's wishful thinking. So, I mean, a slightly different slant on that. Wishes, dreams, contemplation, that seems a little bit more positive, whereas wishful thinking kind of indicates some kind of fantasy or illusion. So an interesting, you know, slight variation there. Now we have peach blossom or peach flower. And these are very similar. Struggle, hard times, captivation, or hard times. Next is the pomegranate flower, which is so pretty. I love this card. In the Floret Oracle, it's maturity, elegance, natural. Whereas in the Victorian flowers, it's joy. So these are fairly different again. Now we have primrose and snowdrop, which is just adorable. In the Floret Oracle, it's inconsistency, stubborn, foolish. Whereas the Victorian flowers is hope. So again, they're really quite different. Some of these cards are so different. Others are almost exactly the same. Rose is wisdom, devotion, order, or an influential person. In many ways, these are quite similar. Like, I imagine, you know, order involving someone who is influential, whether, you know, in a good way or a negative way. And often that person will inspire devotion from other people or will exude wisdom. So that's an interesting take, I think. Now we have scabious and marigold. In the Floret Oracle, it's helping, sharing, support. And in the Victorian flowers, sympathy. So again, similar, like we see helping, sharing, support. They are in many ways similar to sympathy, but sympathy has more of, I don't know, like a sadder sort of approach to it, I think. Like, we can help and share and support in almost any situation, but sympathy, you know, kind of requires something to have gone quite wrong for someone to have lost something. Now we have sweet pea, which is very cute and quite different in its colouring again. And here we have pleasure, indulgence, sensuality in the Floret Oracle and needs and necessities in the Victorian flowers. So these are almost exact opposites. Now we have the thistle. We have pain, friction, protection, and a threat. So, you know, we can see the connection here. You know, if there is a threat, you'll want to protect yourself. There may be pain as a result of the threat. So slightly different, but again, we can see the connection. These ones are almost exactly the same. For tulip, we have prosperity, abundance, charity versus prosperity. And as we can see again, the coloration is really quite different. Here we have the white hat and kind of just a softly decorated dress with red. Whereas here we have quite a bright colored hat with much more color in the dress as well. And then the green and kind of like the detail in the green has is a lot more pronounced in the Victorian flowers. Now, I don't have the original imagery, but I have just had a quick look online. And it seems to me that the Floret Oracle is a lot more faithful to the original artwork. Indeed, I think this would be the original artwork, maybe just slightly softer, maybe a little bit, you know, brighter. And if you up the brightness, it's a little bit more washed out. I don't mean to say that in a bad way, but, you know, whereas I think Bubba Studios, Magic Realist Press, they tend to redraw imagery, not really change it much, but kind of do their own thing with it. So I think this is more the original artwork, and this is, you know, Bubba Studios doing their magic. Also in the imagery that I'm seeing online, it definitely is much more like this with the background, where we have a very soft background, like there's quite a bit of depth between the character and the card and the background, whereas in the Victorian flowers the background is much more prominent, so there's a little bit less of that depth. But that is just something to note. Here we have Verbena, we have Honesty, Rekindle Heart, and here we have Revenge, which again are kind of like the two flip sides of the same coin, aren't they? The opposites. Next we have Violet, Charm, Admiration, Appreciation, and then Shelter and Retreat, which are really quite different. So these two don't even really relate to each other. There's no connection, whether it be opposing to, you know, two sides of the same coin, or just similar connections. These are just completely different, really. Now we have Wallpaper, Shyness, Anxiety, Nerves, and Shyness. So pretty much the same there. Now we have Water Lily, Hope, Harmony, Higher Self, Faith, and Piety. So these again are quite similar, although this sort of language is perhaps a little bit more religious in overtone, whereas this is kind of more, I don't know, it's gentler language, but ultimately very, very similar. And last of the, you know, the same cards in this deck is Wild Rose. And we have Secrets, Questions, Discussion, and a Thorny Question. So again, we see a connection, like a thorny question, perhaps something that's a little bit sharp, a little bit unwanted. Questions indeed is here. And Secrets, there's a connection there too, I think. So those are all of the images that, you know, correspond between the two decks, and that is 33. So it's 33 out of 44 and 33 out of 40. So the majority of, you know, the same cards show up. They're just, some are similar, but some are done in quite different ways in terms of the meanings that are provided. But if we're talking about the actual imagery that's shown up, these are the ones that are, you know, exact copies. Now, our next pile, which is comprised of four cards from each deck, is where the images are the same, but the titles of the cards are different. So not just the keywords, as many of them were in the previous section, but actually the titles of the imagery. This one's fairly similar. Like, we still have the ball. This is just the bell of the ball and the flower of the ball, or the flower ball, I should say. Here we have high tea versus tea and coffee. Both talk about friendships and friends. Then we have the wild color or the water arum. This one is faith, sympathy, and bliss, whereas in the Victorian flowers, it's roots and ties. And then finally, we have moonflower in the Floret Oracle or marvel of Peru. And these meanings are very different. Here we have intuition, illumination, mystery versus party time. So very different cards there, although the same imagery. So these are the three cards from the Victorian flowers that do not exist in the Floret Oracle in terms of the imagery. The first is tuberose and daffodil, which is love, flax, which is skills and craft, and camellia, which is a hidden romance. And that leaves us with seven cards from the Floret Oracle. We have Carnation, which is celebration, festivity, distinction. Tobacco, addiction, dependency, obsession. Myrtle, fidelity, uncomplicated joy. Hydrangea, harsh, deceiving, bragging. The Final Parade, journey, travel, safety. Sunflower, positivity, strength, happiness. And Death, transformation, change, ending. So as I said, there are four extra cards. There's 44 cards in the Floret Oracle compared to the 40 cards in the Victorian Flowers. Now, as for which goes better alongside the Fantastic Menagerie, I mean, that's entirely subjective, isn't it? I mean, of course, you know, the Fantastic Menagerie is done by the same artist as the Victorian Flower. So we definitely get that same kind of like sketchy detail more in the Victorian Flowers, which matches more with the Fantastic Menagerie. Also, the colouring is a lot more similar. And of course, the size of the cards along with the card stock itself is pretty similar too. Whereas the Floret Oracle, it is quite different in comparison, but of course it still marries along nicely because it is the same artwork essentially, well, by the same artist anyway. Also, of course, the card is a lot smaller, so you know, if you like that distinction, or if you want to draw more oracle cards, for example, as opposed to just one or two or whatever it may be, this might be easier to do so on a smaller surface. So basically, both are totally fabulous. They're very, very similar in many ways, and if you don't have access to the Victorian flowers because it is expensive, because it's out of print, then I don't think you can go wrong with the Floret Oracle. There are so many similarities. The majority of the cards are present in both, even if they've got slightly different takes on the meanings. Ultimately, though, I just thought this would be a fun little exercise, and I hope if you've been kind of pining after the Victorian flower like I had for so long, that this gives you a bit of an understanding as to whether you would want to make the investment, and I know it can be quite a big investment for the Victorian flower, or whether you'd be happy for what it is that you want out of the deck, whether you'd be happy with the Floret. I obviously really love both. I've had so much fun with the Floret, and I never felt like I never felt unhappy with the Floret Oracle. It was more just the fact that I wanted the set in many ways. And also I do just really love how Bubba Studios presents their work with the little white book and how beautiful the cardstock is. So in many ways I wanted this because I had the Fantastic Menagerie. And because the Fantastic Menagerie is one of my favorite tarot decks, I did really want that set. But if you just want a pretty little flower deck and you don't really want to spend big, I would highly recommend the Floret Oracle. I think it's such a gorgeous little deck. It's one of those print-on-demand decks, so it's really, really affordable too. And again, thank you so much to those people who helped me fulfill some of these decks on my wish list, especially to Veronica Jude, who really went out of her way to bring this beautiful deck into my life. I couldn't be more grateful. In fact, I'm getting a little bit emotional. Your kindness, and your generosity, as I said, was just kind of really unexpected. Not because I don't think you're generous, but just, you know, when somebody does something like that for you, it's pretty out of the ordinary. And it was a very special experience. So thank you for that. And thank you too for Jacqueline, who also helped me out with some flower decks, including the wildflower reading cards by Sherilyn Darcy. But that is all for this video. I hope you've enjoyed it or found it interesting at the very least. And if you have any comments or questions for me, please feel free to leave those below. I might always do my best to get back to you, and I'll especially do my best to answer any questions you may have. And until next time, so much love. Bye.